we tend to think that numbers are a universal language. Like that if there was a extraterrestrial signal that hit Earth, that it would start with 1 + 1 = 2. And it would work up from there and work up from there and work up from there. And then eventually we're building a machine that opens a wormhole to Vega. And that's a really good idea for formal mathematics and formal logic, and it might work. But the way that humans actually use numbers and we talk to each other, it is not nearly as universal as you might think. I mean, I should say I'm a linguist, not a mathematician. I've kind of moved over to Numberphile briefly here, but my background is linguistics. And the number of ways that humans use numbers, the number of ways that humans use numbers doesn't even make sense. And you might say, okay, there's some weird examples, but English is base 10. But it's not entirely, because we still have dozen, which is base 12. We still have gross, which is 12 times 12, which is 144. That's all base 12. That's duodecimal. We still have score in the language. We still have 47 years ago, which was Abraham Lincoln. He meant 87, but 47 resonates because we used to have base 20 counting. We used to have vigesimal. And that still resonates well in the language today. So we still have all of that. I looked up specifically one linguist called Glendon Lean, who spent 20 years touring around Papua New Guinea, Oceania, all the kind of southeastern areas. He found languages that were base 6. He found languages that were base 15. He found all sorts of outliers that you would find if you have isolated populations on isolated islands. They're not that weird though. I mean, you've done a French video before, right? You have 4, 7, which is 4 20s and 7. That's strange before you even get outside Europe. Hindi is so irregular that for the numbers 1 to 100, you essentially have 100 different words. There is a pattern in there behind them, but the forms are so irregular and they change so much that you basically have to learn 100 different words. Danish is an astonishing one. The Danish number for 58 is, I'm totally not gonna pronounce this correctly, Odo Heltreis, I think. Like, I apologize to the people of Denmark. Odo is 8. That's easy. I think the O's in there as well. Ignore the G, that's just to link things together. And then you've got this, which is Heltreis. Half, third. Now hang on, that's meant to mean 50. So what's going on there? So that is an abbreviation. That is Heltreis Anstuva. Again, I'm sorry, but that is half, thrice, times 20, which still doesn't make any sense, because how can you manage half times 3 times 20? How does that make 50? Well, they get another catch, because this bit here, half thrice, is like Roman numerals. What you've got there is half away from thrice. So this literally means 3 minus a half times 20, which if you actually do the maths on it, is 2.5 times 20, which is 50. So you finally have 58. You have half thrice, 2.5 times 20 + 8, 58. So the complete opposite end of the scale is Tongan, which is wonderful. There are a few more formal ways you can say numbers, but essentially if you are saying a really complicated number like 771,216, you say the numbers for 771216 in order. That's it. It is as simple as that. You just say the numbers. One thing I suspect most of your viewers will think is that at least we've agreed on Arabic numerals now. At least we've got the standard 5, 6, 7, 8, the standard 0 to 9 that everyone uses. Not quite. Some languages, particularly those in India and China, still use their own numeral system, particularly for formal things. Like we still use Roman numerals for clock faces. They might use them in similar places.
And Super Bowl.
And the Super Bowl, of course, yes. Although Super Bowl 50 is going to be Super Bowl 50, 5-0, because Super Bowl L doesn't really sound all that impressive. There's a few other obvious points. Mainland Europe uses a comma for the decimal point and a full stop to separate thousands. UK and US are the other way around. If you're using currency, then there are a whole load of different ways to say and no cents. You might put a slash, you might put a comma and a slash, you might put dot double O. And then there's the big one, because I said thousands separator a while ago, and that's not universal either. And I really got surprised by this when I looked it up. There is not a universal thing for how many digits should be in each group. If you go to South Asia, to India, to Pakistan, to areas around there, you will find they don't use, I mean they do, they can use that as well, but frequently the system that is used is the craw and the lack. Watch a British guy try and explain craw and lack. Your lack is 10 to the 5 and your craw is 10 to the 7. And here's the thing, they are written like this. Your least significant group is 3 digits, and each group that's more significant than that is 2. So you can have a lack craw, which is going to be 10 to the 12, and watch me mess this up. That's 5, that's 7, that's 9, that's 11, which is going to be written like that. That's a trillion. And there's no reason why that should be a trillion instead of a lac craw. It's just what we happen to decide. You might be able to argue that constant threes is maybe a bit more understandable, but that's coming from a really English perspective. I would be absolutely certain that someone who grew up with this system would have just as good a reason why theirs is more logical. Let's say all written, spoken language fails. Let's say you have someone who you have absolutely nothing in common with at all. At least you can gesture, at least you can say, you know, 8 and 9 and things, no. I even thought that was universal until someone I know came back from China and told me that if you are going to be in certain regions in China, you are going to be using hand gestures that are completely different. So you get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm gonna try this, and I know someone in the comments is gonna call me out because my hand position's gonna be a little wrong, but it is roughly 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, or sometimes 10, which are based on the shapes of the original Chinese characters for those numbers. That kind of blew me away, but then I found the paper from Glendon Lean that I mentioned right at the start about Papua New Guinean languages in that area, who use a brilliant thing called a body count tally system. So they will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then depending on which language, it will follow different points around the face, or it might go across and down the other side. Okay, there are a lot of differences between languages, but the majority who use that system, base 27, because you have 27 points that they refer to keep tally. We're not gonna be doing advanced calculus in this. We're gonna be, you know, doing everyday conversations, but that means you can do things like one man and here, 37. You can start keeping tally with things like, and that's wonderful because that is something that I hadn't even thought of, I hadn't even come up with before reading about it. That wasn't something that my mind was open to. What I wanted to do, to have kind of the grand finale, was to look at what science fiction writers had done with alien languages. But they're nowhere even close to that. I looked up Klingon. I looked up Klingon from Star Trek. Klingon is base 10 with words for 1,000 and 1,000,000. It's clearly written by an English speaker, and it's more English and more normal for us, for those of us over here, than half the languages I've talked about. And it's meant to be an alien species. And I know in Star Trek they're all meant to have come from a common ancestor, but that we did come from a common ancestor, and we've got much, much weirder numbers in our own human speech than science fiction has ever come up with. I think that's one of the best things about linguistics, about being human, about all of this, is that someone on the other side of the world, something that they will consider absolutely normal, can completely blow your mind.
We'd like to thank Squarespace for supporting this video. If you want a simple, powerful, and beautiful website, then check them out. I use Squarespace myself for my blog, and I can tell you I'm a really happy customer. But if you're a bit more advanced than me and want to really fine-tune all aspects of your site, then Squarespace's developer tools really let you get under the hood and tinker with everything. So if you've got a great idea for a website, online store, podcast, or anything else that needs a web presence, check them out. You can even give it a trial run, set up a site, see what you think, with no credit card required. And then if you do sign on for a year, they'll throw in a free domain name. Use the offer code NUMBERPHILE and you'll get 10% off your first purchase. So go to squarespace.com/numberphile, remember that offer code, Great stuff. And thank you to Squarespace for supporting Numberphile.